processes, in fact, about what we call the initiation of motion. And before we do that, you have to know some basics. We already discussed that in the introduction course, but I will briefly rehearse it. Why is erosion or the initiation of motion of interest in dredging? Well, first of all, and I will show something about that, if you have the hopper loading process, at the end of the loading process of a hopper, you get very high velocities of the mixture above the sediment, and those high velocities will cause erosion, and they will result in the fact that the efficiency of the loading process goes to zero. So at the end, you are not loading anything anymore. In fact, all the sand that goes into the hopper leaves the hopper through the overflow. And if you can model the erosion well, you can predict the loading process and you can determine when to stop loading. Another process in dredging is the hydraulic transport. And in hydraulic transport is the transport of solids with water, in general with a fluid, but in dredging the fluid is always water. So we transport solids, mainly sand and gravel, through pipelines mixed with water. And if those solids have quite a large particle size, or if the concentration is high, what will happen is that you get a bed, a sediment, in the bottom of the pipe. And that means at the interface between the bed and the fluid, you also have erosion. In fact, the bed forming in such a pipeline is always an equilibrium between settling sedimentation on one hand and erosion on the other hand. So you have to be able to understand the settling process of the particles in the pipeline on one hand and the erosion process on the other hand. But you can also be busy with what we call beach nourishment. Beach nourishment is that there's not enough sand on the beach anymore, and usually with hopper dredges we will dredge sand from the North Sea and pump it on the beach, could be with a pipeline. And then if you do that and you pump the slurry on the beach, what you want is the sand to settle on the beach and the water to flow back through the sea. But you can imagine that if the water flow is too high, if you have relatively too much water, that will cause erosion on the beach, and part of the sand that you are dumping on the beach will flow back to the sea. So it's also interesting to understand that process. So first, the settling process. Well, what do we have? We assume a spherical particle. In reality, the particles are not spherical, they are angular, but we assume a spherical particle. And that spherical particle is subject basically to two forces. You could split it up in three or four forces, but we normally use two forces. You have an upwards force and a downwards force. And if those two forces are equal, that's where you have what we call the terminal settling velocity. We talk about a terminal settling velocity because if you hold a particle in the water and release it, first it has to accelerate to get to that terminal settling velocity. Yeah, so it's the final velocity. What are those two forces? Well, we have the upwards force, which is the so-called drag force. Every object which is in a flow, whether it's a fluid flow or an air flow, doesn't matter, every object will have a drag force. We know from cars, cars have a certain drag force when you are driving high speed. And in fact, it's an easy exercise to determine the power required to overcome this drag force if you know the maximum power and the maximum velocity of your car. The drag force, it's a CD, and I mentioned cars. Usually in good cars, the CD value would be something like 0.25, 0.3. But if you buy a Hummer, probably it's 1. Yeah, the resistance could be 4 times as big, and also the fuel consumption at high speed. Not at low speed, but at high speed. So that's the CD. We will see what the CD is for particles later. Half rho, in this case, the water density, but if it's another fluid, you can use the density of the other fluid. Phi is the terminal settling velocity, because we look at the final velocity, and A is the cross-section of the particle perpendicular to the velocity. So that's one force, that's the upwards, the resisting force, in fact. Then the downwards force is the gravity force. But because we are under water, we have to look at the submerged gravity force, not the gravity force above water, but the gravity force underwater. So you get the density of the particle, in this case, usually it will be quartz, minus the density of water, in order to get the submerged density. Then times G, so then we have the weight, times the volume, and times a shape, a shape factor. Why a shape factor? Well, if we have a sphere, the shape factor is 1. But if you don't have a sphere, if you have a real sand particle, then normally the ratio between the diameter of the particle and the volume of the particle is not 1, it's smaller than 1. For real sand, we often use a factor 0.7, something in that neighborhood. So those are the two forces, and if you make those two forces equal to each other, you will find this equation, which is the general equation for the terminal settling velocity. And you can see you have the 4/3 g, the submerged density, the diameter of the particle, the shape factor, and here the density of water and the CD factor. In many other papers, I also use the VT, the T of terminal. Here I use the S of settling. Both indices you can see. Well, the CD value. If you want to be able to calculate the settling velocity, you have to know the CD value of particles. And this graph is for spheres. What do we see? On the horizontal axis, we have the particle Reynolds number. And the particle Reynolds number is the settling velocity times the diameter divided by the viscosity. And there we already see a problem, because the settling velocity is in the Reynolds number, but we need the settling velocity to determine the settling velocity. So it's an implicit situation, but they already solved that long time ago. Well, what do you have? If you have very small particles, you also have very small Reynolds numbers, and you can see that there is a sort of linear relation between the CD value and the Reynolds number. If I recall correctly, it's 24 divided by the Reynolds number. So the smaller the Reynolds number, the bigger the CD value. That has to do with the fact that in this area, the flow around the particle is laminar. It's viscous flow, so everything is determined by viscous friction. Then, at very high Reynolds numbers in this area, the CD value is almost a constant. And that's because in that area we have turbulent flow around the particle, and that gives us a constant CD value. The CD value for spheres in that area would be about 0.445. Well, you shouldn't say about, because it's 3 decimals, so it's quite accurate. But that's in this area. In between here, of course, you have a transition area where you have some viscous influence and some turbulence influence, and you get a transition curve. Now, at very high Reynolds numbers, you see a sudden jump. And that sudden jump is something you get because if you have the flow around a particle, if you have flow in general, we say the flow is connected to the surface, which means at the surface the velocity of the flow is always zero. Yes, so you get a velocity profile which start at zero at the surface of the object. But at very high Reynolds numbers, there can be a situation where it gets disconnected, where the flow is not in contact with the surface anymore. So the flow will let go of the surface. And because of that effect, suddenly the CD value drops. They use, I don't know if they still use it, but some years ago they used that effect, so this effect in speed skating. They put those strips on the arms and on the head, and those strips take care that the flow will let go of your body, so it's not connected all the way to the body, but it goes straight, it will let go. And the theory is that because of that, the CD value of the skater reduces enormously, and then he can skate faster. Basically, that if it works, because I don't really see it anymore in speed skating, but 10 years ago, huh? It's not allowed, but it works. Okay. What I understood is that it mainly works at the short distance, because that's where you have the high speed. So for the 500 meters and the 1,000 meters, where they really have high speed, they can go up to 60 kilometers an hour. That's where this works, but if you do the 10 kilometers, it seems the effect is already much less. But anyway, I think they also tested this for swimming. And in fact, then you can say, yeah, but in swimming the speeds are much lower, which is true, but then in swimming you are in water, and the density of water is about 1,000 times higher than the density of air. So it could be that you get in the same region and it works. And maybe with the Tour de France, with bicycle riding, it could also work. But I guess you are right, it's not allowed, it's not fair.
No, tomorrow we have a lecture about
sports. Okay, okay. Well, in fact, I know they did a lot of tests about this in the Delft University, because in about 10 years ago there was one of the national skaters who was a student of the TU Delft, and they allowed him to do all the tests in the wind tunnel of the TU Delft. So that's where they tested all of this, and it seemed to work. So, okay, here you see some equations to determine the CD values. You can see for very small Reynolds numbers, 24 divided by the Reynolds number. And then you can, yeah, but how can I determine the Reynolds number because I don't know the settling velocity yet? Well, we will see if we substitute this in the equation, then we will find an explicit equation and we can solve it. The transition area is not really of interest, it's just a mathematical equation to make the two, to connect the two regions. And then in the, for the very high, the turbulent region, high Reynolds numbers, we find the 0.445. But remember, this is all for spheres, yeah, not for real sand particles. Well, this shows, basically it shows the same but it stops before you have that jump, and in this graph I compared a number of equations. Mr. Huisman used to be a professor at civil engineering, and he did a lot of research on this, so he has his equation. Then you have Turton and Levenspiel. They also have a very good equation. In fact, I prefer this equation because it's just one equation which is explicit and it's very easy to use. And if you compare the curves, In fact, here the red one called iteration and the black one called iteration is solving the implicit equations, so that's pure, completely theoretical. But you can see the difference between the four equations and then here the observed points. The difference is not too much, so in fact all the equations would do pretty well. And if you talk about real sand, the problem is much more, what is the real shape factor of the sand, and the accuracy in that shape factor is much less than the accuracy of those equations. This graph shows you particles of many different shapes. Here you can see the shape factors. Well, the shape factor starts with 1.0, so those are the spheres. Those are the red triangles you see at the bottom, and they are at about 0.445, but you can see it's not even exactly. But then it goes to a shape factor of 0.3, which are those plus signs, so that's over here. And that means this is 1, this is 2, so we are around 3, a shape CD value of about 3. Well, if you have particles with a shape factor of 0.3, what does it look like? Well, for example, if you have shell, you know, the shells in the sea, shells will, if they settle, they will settle like the way leaves fall from a tree. So it will be like this. And just throw a complete shell in the water and you will see it does something like this. So those things are like shells. And in fact, shells are also important in dredging, because it happens very often that when you dredge at the sea or near a beach, the sand is full of shells, or at least shell fragments. That means you get those pieces of shell in your pipeline, and what do they do? Well, because they have such a high drag coefficient, they will not settle very easily. Yeah, because they will go like this, and before they reach the bottom of the pipe, there is some turbulence moving them up again. But once they settle, once they cover the bed, the CD value in the other direction is so small that the flow cannot erode them anymore. So they will cover the bed, protect the bed, and that means even if the dredge master would increase the line speed in the pipeline, you can hardly remove those shells from the bed anymore, so you are in trouble. And last year I think we did some research into this, and we found that most shell fragments can be compared to particles of 2 millimeter if you want to calculate how high the speed should be to erode them. So if I know the line speed to erode particles of 2 millimeter, I should use such a line speed to erode the shell fragments, even though they could be thinner. Usually shell fragments are much thinner than 2 millimeters, but that's what you need. Yeah, and you see many shape factors in between. Well, there have also been people in the past who actually investigated the settling velocity of sand particles, real sand particles. And then, of course, the result depends on where did the sand come from. If it's from an estuary, probably the particles are already quite rounded, so the CD value will not be too high. But if it would be from a lake in the mountains, you have very angular particles, and that could give a different result. But anyway, those are the equations you will find everywhere in literature. For very fine particles, smaller than 0.1 millimeter, we use the Stokes equation, and you can see the fact that it was implicit in the beginning has been solved by substituting those CD equations. And you find a relatively simple equation, but you can see the settling velocity is proportional to the square of the particle diameter. Yeah. Then we will not look at the transition, that's this, but for particles bigger than 1 millimeter, we find the so-called Ritinger equation, and you can see that the velocity is proportional to the square root of the particle diameter. In all those equations, and that's still how everybody puts them in literature, the particle diameter is in millimeters, and the velocity is in millimeters per second. So they didn't use the SI system, but I wanted to show you the original equations. So if you use them, be careful, it's millimeters and millimeters per second. And in most other equations, we will use the SI system, which means everything is in meters and meters per second. And there's a factor 1,000 between. So you have to compensate for that at an exam if you would use those equations. At the bottom, I show the equation for the what I call the relative submerged density. Some people call it the specific gravity or the specific density, but I call it the relative submerged density because it's relative to water, so it's the weight of particles underwater. So you get the quartz density minus the water density divided by the water density. And for most normal sands, this thing would have a value roughly 1.65, but it depends on what density would you use for water. Most of the time we just use 1.0, but if you have salt water with quite a high salt content, the density could be 1.03, and if you use the 1.03 here and here, then the relative submerged density would be 1.59. Yeah, because you are not dividing by one anymore. And that could make a small difference in the outcome. So, with examination questions, I always take into account that one person will use the one and another will use the 1.03, and so there's always a small margin in the outcome of calculations. This is what it looks like. The red line is the Stokes line. Here you see the settling velocity in millimeters per second. So I did that because then you can connect it to the equations. So red is the Stokes line, blue is the Ritinger line, green is the transition line. And in fact, what I found is that the transition equation almost perfectly covers this area for very small particles, but also the area of big particles. So why would I use three equations if that transition equation already covers everything? I found a fourth equation of Mr. Zanke, a German professor. He still exists. And you can see that for the small particles, it's exactly the same. For the big particles, he found a slightly higher settling velocity, but the difference is not too much. So you can use that. And the Zanke equation, the nice thing about it is that it doesn't just contain the particle diameter, it also contains the viscosity of the fluid. So I could compensate for temperature, for example. Because if I'm dredging at the North Pole where the water is 4 degrees, the viscosity of the water is much higher than when I'm dredging in the tropics where the water is 25 degrees. The difference could be maybe 50%, maybe even more. Yeah, so you can compensate for that if you use the Zanke equation. So in fact, right now I'm busy with research on hydraulic transport, and I'm searching for data in literature, and I found a PhD thesis of a guy from Canada, and with each test he mentioned the temperature at which he did the test, and the temperatures range from 9 degrees up to 25 degrees. So using this equation I can compensate for the viscosity by using the Zanke equation, while if you would use the Stokes equation, yeah, you only have the diameter to play with. You cannot change other things. So that's why I prefer the Zanke equation. Here I did some calculations just to show you the difference with different shape factors. So here you can see three cases with 0.7, which would be normal sand. And then here you see some cases with 0.5. 0.5 means a much more angular sand. And you can see there is a difference between the two. In the graph, it doesn't seem the difference is too high. But if, for example, if you take this point at 1 millimeter per second, and I go to the other shape factor here, I would have 15 or something like that, which is a difference of 50%. Yeah, so you can see the shape factor really matters. This one is not important now. One more thing about settling, and that's hindered settling. In many applications in civil engineering, the concentrations of the solids in the fluid are not too high. And if you have normal erosion and you look at the sediment transport through a river, concentrations are not too high. Maybe civil engineers disagree with me, but in our application, it's low concentrations. At low concentrations, the settling velocity is not influenced too much by the concentration. It's influenced, but not too much. But we go up to concentrations of, let's say, 50%. So in dredging nowadays, they really, with those big hopper dredges, they really dredge densities of 1.6, 1.7. And then you have concentration, volumetric concentrations, between 40 and 50%. That's much higher than normally what you will find in rivers. Well, what happens if you have a 40% concentration and the particles start settling? That means the volume, first of all, the volume of the particles that are settling, which is a volume moving down, the same volume of water has to move up, which means the settling velocity is the relative velocity between the water and the particles. So if I have an upwards flow velocity of the water, the absolute settling velocity will be reduced. So that's one effect. But you also have another effect, that if a particle is settling and there's a particle behind it, then the particle behind it will be influenced by the velocity of the particle in front. And that's why in the Tour de France, all those bicycle riders, they ride behind each other when they are going at very high speed, because the first one should catch the wind, and then everybody will go behind it. So you have a number of effects in high concentrations. On one hand, the upwards velocity of the water. On the other hand, the fact that particles can be in the shadow of other particles. And the total effect is that the settling velocity will be reduced as a function of the concentration. Long time ago, there were two researchers. In fact, you had Mr. Richardson and Mr. Tsarki. Here I mention Richardson. From what I remember, Richardson was the student of Mr. Tsarki, but because Richardson did the research in his master thesis, he was the first author of the publication. And if you look at the scientific impact, then the score of Mr. Richardson and Tsarki is very low. Why is that? Well, the way they determine the score, and that's good for you as a PhD to know, the way they determine the score is they count the number of references to each paper, and then your score is, so suppose you have 10 papers, And the 10th paper has 10 references, and the first 9 have much more, then your score is a 10. That's what we call the Hirsch index. So they look at which publication is the number of references the same. So if you have 10 papers, the 10th paper has 10 references, your score is a 10. So those people, they just have one paper with 6,000 references. But in the way they calculate the Hirsch index, their score is 1 because they just have one paper. So they have a Hirsch index of 1, but they have officially 6,000 references, but then officially maybe 100,000, because also in all our student reports, everybody who is busy with this is referring to those people, but you will not find it in the statistics. So I'm a little bit critical on the system. You can understand. So what does it look like? Well, Vs was the terminal settling velocity of one particle. Vc is the terminal settling velocity if you have a certain concentration. And the ratio between the two is 1 minus the volumetric concentration to a power of beta. This beta you can see in this graph. So for very small Reynolds numbers, the beta is, I think, normally we use this line. It's 4.69, I thought. And then for high Reynolds numbers, it's 2.3, 2.4. With this equation, you can determine the beta if you know the Reynolds number of the particle. So it's quite a high power, and that means if you would have a concentration, let's say 0.4, yeah, then you get 0.6 to the power of something like 4. Well, that becomes a very small number, and that means with 40% concentration, there's not much left of the settling velocity. Then you can also imagine that if you are loading a hopper dredge and you do that with a very high concentration, the sand is hardly settling anymore because the concentration is so high. Yeah? And you have to take that into account if you want to predict how much time do I need to fill up my hopper dredge. Okay, then we go to erosion. Well, I already told you one of the applications is the hopper dredge, because we like to know what happens at the end of the loading process. I assume everybody already knows how a hopper dredge works. I don't assume everybody has been on a hopper dredge, but maybe later that will happen. And let's take a look at the loading process. I hope, well, in the PDF I will put on Blackboard, you can study this graph a little bit better. But what we normally do, at the horizontal axis you have time. Here you have zero. Zero is when we actually start dredging. But to get all the information from the graph, we always start the graph at the point where the previous cycle stopped dredging. So where the hopper is completely full with sand and we start sailing. So that's here in this case, minus 250 minutes. So we start where the ship is full and we start sailing. Then the first thing that happens is that there is still some water above the sediment. Yeah, because when we stop dredging, when we turn off the pumps, you have sediment in the hopper with a layer of water on top. Well, we want to get rid of that water because that water is weight. Weight causes draft of the ship, and the more draft you have, the more resistance the ship will have sailing back to the borrow area or the dump area. So we want to get rid of it. That's this small line. Then we get phase two, which is just sailing to the dump place. Then you get phase three. Phase three is dumping, so emptying the ship. And phase three can be in three ways. I already explained, I think, in the introduction course. You can use your bottom doors or valves. So in the bottom of the ship you have doors, valves, you open them, and by gravity the material will flow out. Usually we also use some water jets to make it easier and faster. But the other two ways are that you fluidize the sand in the hopper, so you don't open the bottom doors, you just fluidize the material at the bottom of the hopper. It will go into a pipeline to the pump, and then with the pump you can either use rainbowing or you use a floating pipeline. Well, in both cases, the unloading will cost about the same time as the loading. So this is a picture where you use the bottom doors, which takes maybe 5 minutes. Yeah, it's a matter of minutes. But if you would fluidize the load in the hopper and pump it ashore, it could take an hour. It completely depends on the hopper and the sand and etc., etc., but it takes much longer. Okay, here in phase four, the hopper is empty. But in practice, it's not completely empty, because if the bottom doors were open, then what will happen is that the level of the water inside the hopper is the same as outside. Yeah, that's the way it works. So when you close those bottom doors, there's water in the hopper. So in fact, this graph is not 100% correct, because there is water in the hopper. Now, in some cases, the contractor will say, I will remove that water because I want to start with an empty hopper. Nowadays, there are also cases where they say it's better to start with a hopper full of water. But at this point, you don't want the water because it causes draft of the ship, so you don't like it. You sail back to the what we call the borrow area, so that's the area where you are actually dredging, and there you start dredging. I will not explain the different types of hoppers, because you have two ways of loading of a hopper, but you start loading up to a point where you reach the overflow level. Until you reach the overflow level, everything will stay in the hopper, water and sand. Yeah, because you don't reach the overflow, so the mixture cannot go anywhere. So it stays in the hopper. Here you reach the overflow, so what happens after you reach the overflow? Every time when 1 cubic meter of mixture goes into the hopper, 1 cubic meter of water should leave the hopper through the overflow, because the volume is limited. Yeah, so sand is replacing water. So that's why the steepness of this curve is much less, because you are replacing water with sand. Then at this point we reach the point where you the total load in the hopper is at a maximum, so the total weight is at a maximum. This is what we call a constant tonnage loading system. After we reach the maximum weight in the hopper, automatically the overflow is lowered by hydraulic cylinders in order to keep the total weight in the hopper constant. So every time when I replace water by sand, the weight is increasing, because the weight of the sand is 2.65 and the weight of the water is 1.0. So I have to lower my overflow, otherwise the weight would increase and the ship would sink. And we don't want that. So this is the region where you have a constant tonnage in your hopper by lowering the overflow. But now we talk about the total weight in the hopper. If we look at the effective weight is the weight of the sand. And you can talk about effective weight in two ways. You can say, okay, I will count the sediment including the pore water, or I'm only counting the weight of the solids. And that's two ways of counting. Well, this graph is the sediment including the pore water, and this line is just the weight of the solids, and if you know the porosity of the sand, it's just a factor. Yeah, it's simple. Now, what do we do? So here you see the weight of the sediment, and at the end, somewhere here, you get erosion, and you get a curve. If you would continue the graph, it would become horizontal at the point where everything that goes into the hopper leaves the hopper because the erosion is so high. Yeah, so now, when should we stop loading? Well, what is production? Production is the total amount of solids, whether you include the pore water or not, doesn't matter. It's the total amount of solids divided by time. And then you get either cubic meters per second or you get tons per second, whatever you like. So if what do I want? I want my production to be at a maximum. Yeah, because if I have maximum production, I earn the most money. And basically, contractors are not in the world just to transport sand. They also want to make money. They want to have a profit. So if I make a line from my starting point to the curve, the point where that line is a tangent, a raaklijn in Dutch, a tangent with the curve, with the loading curve, that's the point where I have maximum production. Because if I divide the load by the time, this is the load, this is the time, so the where this angle is at a maximum, I have my maximum production, right? So that's what I do. I draw this line, I see where it just touches the loading line. Well, that's in this point. I go down and I see that I should stop after about 75 minutes. Because if I would load longer, you can see the curve is becoming horizontal here, and that means this angle will decrease again. So my production will also decrease. Yeah, so I should stop at that point. Now the problem in real dredging, of course, is this is theoretical, but if you don't understand the theoretical case, how can you find something for real life? The problem is that you measure all those signals with a certain accuracy. Yeah, how to measure the load in your hopper, how to measure it? Well, how they do it, if you put pressure sensors in the bottom of your ship, then you can measure the draft at that point of your ship. So if you do that at a number of points in the bottom of your ship, you can measure the bottom line of the ship. If you know the whole shape of your ship, so from the shipyard who built it, you get, we call it the Carène diagram, which shows you the whole shape of the ship, then if you know a number of points at the bottom of the ship, you can calculate the water displacement of the ship, because you know exactly which part is underwater. Okay, so if I can calculate the water displacement of the ship, I know the total weight of the ship. Yeah, it's the ship, including all the sand and everything. I can also do that before I start dredging. And that way, I measure the weight of the empty ship. Then, if I deduct those two things from each other, I have the weight of the load. But you should realize this means I take the difference of two very big numbers. So what is the accuracy? Yeah, but there is no other way, because I cannot put a 50,000 cubic meter hopper on a weighing device in the ship. That's impossible. And so this is the only way to do it. Now, I also need the volume of the material in the hopper. So what do they have? They have those acoustic transducers above the hopper, and with those acoustic transducers they measure the water surface in the hopper. And because if you are loading the hopper, the sand will not settle equally over the full surface, because it depends on where is the inlet, where is the overflow. So the ship may also have some trim. So I need to measure at a number of spots what is the surface of the water. But if I know it, and again in combination with the design of the whole shape of the hopper, I can calculate the volume of material in the hopper. So then I have my volume and I have my weight. Yeah? Yeah.
So, do you measure the contents of your hopper, but you don't know how much water equal to the sand is?
No, but the thing is, if I know, but Kees will explain that in the next lecture, because he's talking about hopper loading, but if you know the weight in the hopper, and you know the total volume in the hopper, you can calculate how much sediment is in the hopper. You need those two numbers in order to calculate. So in order to calculate this curve, because what I measure is this curve, and what I measure is the volume in the hopper. Those two numbers I can measure. And then based on that, I can construct this curve or this curve, and those two. But now I have something we call the law of Bernoulli. Everybody should be familiar with that. So that means if I measure the pressure at the bottom of the hopper and the ship is sailing, I have pressure plus half rho v squared is a constant. So if I have velocity, the pressure is lower. So I measure a lower pressure, so I think there is less material in the hopper. So, yeah, when to measure. It also happens, for example, in IJmuiden, there's a lot of sand and gravel dredging in the North Sea, and then those ships come into the port. But at the entrance of the channel in IJmuiden, there is an undeep area. So if the ship sails over that undeep area, suddenly the layer of water under the ship is much less, which means the velocities under the ship will be much higher. And every time when you pass that, it looks like there's less material in the hopper. And everybody knows it's not true. But if you want to have an accurate measurement, in fact, the ship should stop, should not have speed at all. But yeah, they want to go on because it will cost time if you stop. So it's still difficult to do it accurately. Last year I had a case in a company where they had measurements, and we were comparing the measurements with the theory, and I found some strange things, and then I analyzed the measurements, and it appeared one of the acoustic transducer broke down. So they measured the volume of the hopper just based on one correct transducer and one wrong transducer. Yeah, and then the signal in your computer goes anywhere, and you get very. But if they would still use those signals, yeah, either you get paid too less or too much. But something is wrong. Okay, we will have a break. What it looks like at the end of the loading cycle. So you have a hopper full of sediment. This is the inlet, but in reality the inlet will look differently, because an inlet like this would cause a lot of turbulence, and you don't want that. But anyway, this is what it could look like, and then you get a high flow of the mixture above the sediment, and if those flow velocities are too high, nothing will settle anymore. In fact, whether it's erosion or whether the material just will not settle anymore, that's a complicated question. Probably it's an equilibrium where still some particles will settle, but at the same time the same amount of particles will erode. You can model such a thing in a very simple way. So first I will show you the simple way. You assume a number of particles on top of the sediment. You have a flow above it. That flow will result in a shear stress on top of the particles. The particles have a certain weight, and at the bottom those particles have a friction coefficient with the rest of the sediment, which results in a friction force F. And at the moment where, or a friction stress, it's also a shear stress. At the moment where the driving shear stress of the fluid is equal to the resisting shear stress of the friction, the particles will start moving, and that's what we call initiation of motion. You should distinguish between initiation of motion and erosion, because initiation of motion determines when particles will start to move. It will not give you an answer on how many particles are moving. When we talk about erosion, we always talk about the flux of particles that are being transported. So in kilograms per second or tons per second or whatever. But erosion is the amount of material that's moving. In the initiation of motion is the moment where it starts moving. Yeah, so those are two different things. What we will discuss is initiation of motion. When do particles start to move? Well, if you look at this problem, then we get an equation where the S is the velocity, the D is the diameter of the particle, and this equation gives you the velocity where particles of that diameter will start moving. In the equation you find the friction coefficient, of course, because we have friction at the bottom, the porosity of the sediment, and this lambda is the friction coefficient at the top of the bed based on the so-called Moody diagram. And there are many equations for that to determine the lambda. Usually that lambda will have a value of 0.01, 0.02. It depends on the particle size, in fact. If we use normal values for friction coefficient, lambda, etc., you will get this equation, which looks a little bit like the equation for the settling velocity. It's quite similar. You can also reverse this equation, and then you get this equation. And what is the use of that? Well, the use of that is that if I know the velocity above the bed, I can calculate the diameter of a particle that will just start moving. And normally when you are loading a hopper, you know the velocity above the bed, because that's what you can calculate. And then I can calculate which particles will start moving, and then I assume that particles that start moving will not settle anymore. History. The whole theory about initiation of motion started in 36, when an American, Mr. Shields, did research in a German laboratory. And Mr. Shields, he found that if you are below a certain curve, you will not have particles that are moving. If you are above that curve, particles start moving. And Mr. Shields, he made a graph like this, and you can see the points that he measured. On the horizontal axis of this graph, you have the Reynolds number, not exactly of the particle, but the Reynolds number of the boundary flow. And vertically, he made another dimensionless parameter, which nowadays we call the Shields parameter. But in fact, that Shields parameter is the dimensionless shear stress. Later I will show you how you can determine those things. It's not too complicated. So what do we see? We see this, well, in fact, it's not a line. It has a certain bandwidth, yeah, a certain thickness. And that's because you can never say exactly If I'm below a certain point, I have movement of the particle, and above that line, I don't. There is a certain bandwidth. Inside that bandwidth, particles could start moving. Yeah. So, but that's usually in science. You will find most of the time you will find a bandwidth, and you can say there's a probability that if I'm inside that bandwidth, it starts moving in this case. Then, after Mr. Shields, other people continued with this research. So basically what they do, they have what we call a flume, which normally is a rectangular cross-section, very long. You put sediment at the bottom, and then you have a certain flow velocity over the bed. And you can increase that flow velocity, and at the moment where particles start moving, you say, hey, I have another point for my graph. And then you can decide if I have one particle that starts moving, or do I need 10 per square meter or 100 per square meter. And in fact, different researchers have different criteria, and that's also why it's difficult to compare all the research from the past, because people may have had different criteria for what do they call initiation of motion. But anyway, this is a graph of somebody else, and those black points, as far as I recall, are the points of Mr. Shields, and the other points are from other people. So basically, again, if you are below this bandwidth, so in this area, there should not be initiation of motion. If you are above, particles start moving. Still, you can see points here that are below where it also started moving. Well, one of the things, and we will see later, is that the CD value, so the drag coefficient, plays an important role. And what did people do? Most researchers in the past did research with spheres. And a sphere has a relatively low drag coefficient. We already saw that in one of the graphs. Then if suddenly you do research with real sand, and real sand has a much higher drag coefficient, that means the resisting force, or the pressure force of the fluid on the particle is much bigger. So if you use real sand or gravel, the whole curve should go down, should be lower, because it's easier for particles to start moving. Here you can see the points of Mr. Shields and a fit curve. There are some fit curves that you can find in literature. I often use Soulsby and Whitehouse for that, but there are many more equations. With some equations, you can see that for very small particles, you have a horizontal asymptotic behavior. While in the original theory of Mr. Shields, he thought here you have a line under a certain angle moving up. And the whole point is that the particles in that area are so small that, yeah, the question is, can I still talk about particles? And I did some research on that myself, because if the particles become so small, you should consider sand is chemically inert, and sand particles are so big that van der Waals forces do not play a role. But if I go all the way here, I'm talking of particles of 1 micron. And if I have particles of 1 micron, also if they are quartz, so they are chemically inert, but 1 micron quartz particles are subject to van der Waals forces. And that means suddenly those forces, they are attractive forces, so those very tiny particles will start sticking together. That means it's much more difficult to make them start moving. Yeah, because either they behave like a bigger particle because they stick together, or the attractive forces pulling them downwards is so big that the water can hardly make them erode. So yeah, you could say Mr. Shields is right and it goes up because of those van der Waals forces. But if you do not count the van der Waals forces, you probably get a horizontal asymptotic behavior. Well, here you have a lot of measurements of different researchers. At the bottom you can find which researchers are used. And I didn't put any curve in this graph, just to give you a feeling, what does it look like? Well, what you can see is this could start with an asymptotic behavior and go down, but it could also go straight up. Yeah, if you look at the cloud of points, you also see that there is quite some bandwidth. But what you can see is that in this area there is supposed to be a sort of minimum, and in this area it looks like it's horizontal again. Yeah, but this is what you get as a researcher. I digitized all those points from literature, so all the points are real measurements. But I also found that, for example, those yellow points, they were from real sand, so they have a higher drag coefficient, while the other colors were measurements of spheres. So it's not strange that you see many of the yellow points lower than the other points. This is another way of looking at it, Mr. Hjelström, also in 36, and you will see that more often in science, that at the same moment in different places in the world people start finding the same kind of results. Why? Because at that moment science is ready for such a thing. So Mr. Hjelström is from Scandinavia. He did his research independent from Mr. Shields, and Mr. Hjelström made a graph which is easier to use, but it also has a disadvantage. The advantage of the Shields curve is that because he used dimensionless parameters on both axes, so you can put all the measurements in one graph because it's dimensionless. The advantage of Mr. Hjelström is that on the axis, here you see the grain size and here you see the flow velocity above the material. So if you know your particle size and you know the flow velocity, immediately you can see what is my, where do I get erosion. Basically this is the Hjelström curve. So this is where you get erosion, and if you try to convert the Shields curve to the Hjelström curve, this part is roughly the same. This part is not, but if you look at it, he says erosion of consolidated mud. Mud consolidated could be something like clay, and you can imagine if you have a flow above clay, it's much more difficult to get erosion than when you have a sand-like material. I found later that if I do the full Shields curve for sand and I project it, then you get a line that continues going down. Yeah, but apparently Hjelström did his research in this area for sand and this area for mud, clay-like or silt. So, yeah, what are you comparing? This is the same Hjelström curve, but I made some fit equations to be able to calculate the whole curve. And also with Hjelström you have a certain bandwidth, so the top is the green line, the bottom is the red line, and that's the roughly the bandwidth that you have in the Hjelström graph. But again, the advantage is, if you know your particle diameter, you just go up here and you say, okay, if I have this velocity, at that velocity the material will start eroding. Yeah, so it's easy to use. Disadvantage, like I said, it's not dimensionless. This graph is valid for a layer of water on top of the sediment of 100 centimeters. If you have a different thickness of the layer of water, you get a different graph. So for each water layer, you need a different graph, yeah, because it's not dimensionless. So, but everybody is using this graph, and I never saw in literature a set of graphs for different water depths. So everybody is ignoring the fact that this is for 1 meter, but it is. This is what you get if you project the Shields curves in the Hjelmström graph. And if you look carefully, you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4 graphs. I did it for 1 centimeter water depth, 0.1, 1 and 10 meters of water depth. And then you can see how those curves differ. Then the red lines here are for here sand and here clay. The green lines are for sand. So if you look at the green line and you have pure sand, in fact very fine sand we call silt, you get those green lines, so it continues going down. Yeah, but those lines are exactly the Shields curves for those water depths. This is a graph which has different names. It's also often called the Parker Shields graph. It's in the coordinates of the Shields graph. Here you have the Reynolds number. In this case, it's the particle Reynolds number, which is a little bit different from the boundary Reynolds number. In the lecture notes, I give you all the equations to go from one Reynolds number to the other, so you can make the transition. Tau star is the Shields number, is the dimensionless shear stress. Yeah, so basically, this is the Shields curve, and this line here is the Shields curve. In this graph, they use the so-called Brownlee equation. So Mr. Brownlee is one of the people who made fit functions for the Shields curve. So the black line is the Brownlee equation. Now, what can you do with this graph? And that's something I will use for the exam as well. If you, for a certain situation, if you calculate where you are in this graph, you can say, okay, if I'm below the black line, no erosion. If I'm above the black line, so we forget the bandwidth that we have, if I'm above the black line, I have erosion. But the graph tells you much more. If I'm above the red line here, the material will be in suspension. Yeah, so all the particles are floating. If I'm below the red line, the particles are what we call saltating. Saltating means a particle, when it starts moving, moves up in the flow, and because of gravity, it falls down again. Yeah, so it's like jumping of particles. So that's what you have below the red line. Then we have this purple line. If I'm on the left side of the purple line, I have ripples. And ripples are, for example, if you go to the beach and at low tide, you see all those small ripples on the beach. Yeah, so ripples are vertical motions of the sediment, but with a small amplitude. Gewoon rimpels in Dutch. If I'm on the right side of the purple line, I have dunes. So, in fact, you could say dunes are ripples with a much higher amplitude. Basically, that's what it is. And it's also a little bit nonsense to say there is one line dividing the two, because in nature, what will happen, if I go from left to right, the amplitude will slowly increase. Yeah, and then if I make a definition, for example, below 1 centimeter amplitude, I call it a ripple, and above I call it a dune. Yeah, okay, then that's the division. But in reality, it's a gradual increase of the amplitude. Then, if you are in this area, you don't have dunes, you have a flat bed. Now, the person who made this graph, of course, he based all those lines on many experiments. It's never black and white, so you can't say in one area it's always flat. There will be some researcher in this area who also measured ripples or dunes. Yeah, that's possible. But on average, that's what you get. So if you have to make a prediction, what kind of flow do I expect, I can use this graph. Why is it important to know where you are? Well, the resistance, the lambda value that we get from the Moody diagram depends on what we call the relative roughness of the surface. Well, if I have a flow through a steel pipe, the relative roughness is almost zero. Yeah, I call it a smooth pipe. But if I have sediment, and on top of the sediment I have ripples of, let's say, 1 centimeter, then suddenly the roughness of my bed is 1 centimeter. It's not the particle diameter anymore, it's the height of the ripples. If I have dunes, then the height of the dunes is the roughness of my bed. And that's what I should use in the Moody diagram to calculate the friction factor. So that's why it's important to know something about what are we talking about. So if I look at flow through a pipeline, then I can actually see that if I'm transporting an 0.1 millimeter sand, that means I'm all the way in this range, it will be in suspension, and most probably I have some small ripples. Okay, so I can calculate the lambda value of my bed. But if I would have gravel through that pipe and I'm in this range, I could have much higher ripples, which we call dunes. And that means the resistance factor over there is much higher. And I should know those things because the dredging contractor would like to know how much power do I need to pump the material through the pipeline. Yeah. A little bit about the flow. If you look at the flow, and in this case we look at flow in a river or a canal or the top of the hopper, so this is not a closed system like a pipeline, but an open system, then we assume that above the bed we have a viscous layer. Because there the velocities are relatively small, we assume that we have a laminar flow, no turbulence, laminar flow. And in fact, in reality, the thickness of that layer is smaller than what you see in this picture. But I needed to get this text in between, so I had to increase the thickness of the layer in the picture. Yeah, so those thicknesses are not reality. They are a little bit exaggerated. Well, then you get a transition layer and then the turbulent logarithmic layer. So this is the viscous sublayer and this is the turbulent layer. And that could be important because if I have very small particles which are entirely in the viscous sublayer, then the flow around those particles is completely different from particles that are so big that they are in the turbulent layer. Yeah, the CD value, you already saw the CD value. The CD value for laminar flow, the Stokes region, could become very high, while the CD value in the turbulent layer for big particles is just 0.445 or something near there. So you get a completely different behavior, whether it's in the viscous sublayer or in the turbulent layer, and in between you always have a transition. I'm not going to read this. You can follow this on Blackboard because I put the whole presentation on Blackboard again. Then something we use constantly, not just here but also in some other subjects, friction velocity. In this subject they use the term friction velocity to determine, in fact, the shear stress on the bed. Friction velocity is not a velocity, They call it friction velocity, but in reality it's not a velocity, but it has the dimension of velocity. So how do you use it? Friction velocity, U star, is the square root of the shear stress on the bed divided by the density of the fluid. That's the definition. And if you do a dimensional analysis, you will find that it's the dimension of velocity, and that's why they call it friction velocity. But remember, it's not a velocity, so there is not a specific point in the flow where you can say, that's where I have my friction velocity. There will be a point where the velocity is equal to the friction velocity, but it's not defined as a point in the flow where you have this velocity. Well, how can I determine it? Because if you look at the first equation, you will say, yeah, very nice, but still I don't know the shear stress. And if I don't know the shear stress, how do I know my friction velocity? Well, there is a general equation. U star squared is lambda divided by 8. The lambda is the lambda that you get from the Moody diagram. I will explain after this. And the U squared is the average velocity above the bed. So if I know, for example, in this hopper, I still have 1 meter of water above the bed, and I know my flow in cubic meters per second, I can calculate the average velocity above the bed, and that's my U. The reason why I put critical here, in fact I should remove it, because that's to be exactly on the Shields curve. Yeah? You have a U critical if you are on the Shield, but to use this equation, forget the critical, it's just the average velocity above the bed. So if I know this velocity, and I know it, and in a river it would be the average flow velocity in the river, if I know it, all I need to know is my lambda, but for the lambda I need to know a little bit more. Well, here we have one of the equations for lambda. You can see two equations. The only difference is here I use the natural logarithm and here the 10 logarithm. Nowadays, everybody will say, yeah, we use the natural logarithm. But in the past, before we had computers, what did people do? We had this double logarithmic paper, and that was based on the 10 logarithm. So people would put all their measurements in on that kind of paper, try to make a straight line through those points, and then you always get equations based on the 10 logarithm. Yeah, so it's just because we had that kind of paper and that's what we used. Yeah, there is no philosophical background behind it. So the only difference is those two logarithms, and you can see that it only results in a different factor in the denominator. That's all. So if you would calculate the ln of 10, you have that factor that's between those two. So what do we have in the equation? Let's take this one. D normally is the diameter of the particles of the sediment. Yeah, if I assume a smooth surface, then I can use the diameter of the particles, and the big D is the hydraulic diameter of the flow. So in a pipe it would be the diameter of the pipe, but if you have a rectangular cross-section, you use the hydraulic diameter. And next time, so that's tomorrow, I will go into detail about the diameter, because like we just discussed, you have a hydraulic diameter and a hydraulic radius, and for mechanical engineers everybody will say, yeah, so the hydraulic radius is half the hydraulic diameter. It's not, unfortunately. It's 1/4 of the diameter. Doesn't make sense to mechanical engineers, but the reason for it is that in civil engineering, in hydraulic engineering, you like to have a number that matches the water depth of a river or a canal, because you often do calculations on that. And if you take 1/4 of the hydraulic diameter, you have the water depth. Well, in the case where you have a very wide river and not too much water depth. I will show you that tomorrow. Okay, so this is the diameter of the particles, diameter of the hydraulic diameter, and this is the Reynolds number of the flow. So it's not the Reynolds number of the particle or anything, it's just the average velocity of the flow times the hydraulic diameter divided by the viscosity. In case you know you have ripples with a certain height, for this d, for this small d, you could use the height of those ripples, if you know them. Normally I just work with the diameter of the particles, but it depends on what you know about the situation. If you don't know, you shouldn't just start using something. Here we see two cases. So you see the velocity distribution again above the bed. Here you have the viscous sublayer, and here you have the turbulent layer. Here you see a particle or an obstacle which is entirely inside the viscous sublayer. So if I determine forces, flow forces on that object, I have to use the velocity distribution in the viscous sublayer. But here you can see particles that are bigger than the viscous sublayer. Yeah, and then I also have to take into account the turbulent flow. Now, in the viscous sublayer, this is your velocity distribution. Yeah, so this is the velocity, this is the friction velocity, this is the distance above the bed, and this is the viscosity. So you can see if my distance above the bed is zero, my velocity is zero, and that's the no-slip condition of flow. And you can see that it goes with the square of the friction velocity. But since this is a constant in a certain case, this gives me a linear velocity distribution. In the turbulent layer, this is the equation, so you get a logarithmic profile where Z0 is some constant depending on the type of flow that you have. Z again is the distance above the bed, and here you have the friction velocity, and kappa is the the Boltzmann constant. Oh no, the von Karman constant, which is roughly 0.4. So that's how you in the Boltzmann equation you also use it. But okay. Then we have a classification of flows. You have smooth flow, and hydraulically smooth flow is when this is a Reynolds number. In fact, this is the Reynolds number Mr. Shields was using, where the Ks is the roughness of the bed, and if you have a smooth bed, you take the diameter of the particle. But if it's not smooth, you have to take, often in civil engineering they use 5 times the diameter, I think. You have numbers for that. Rough flow is when this Reynolds number is above 70. So this is below 5, this is above 70, and in between you have so-called transitional flow. But transitional flow is the equations you will find is always just some mathematics to make two curves match. Yeah, there's no real theory behind it. This in fact shows those velocity distributions. So here you see the linear equation, and here you see the logarithmic equation. We already saw hydraulically smooth below 5 for this Reynolds number. Yeah, and as long as you don't know more, just assume Ks is the particle diameter. It's roughly in the order, the magnitude of the particle diameter. So if I have smooth flow, my Z0 for the turbulent layer is this equation. If I have rough flow, it's proportional to the particle diameter. And in between you get a combination of the two in the transition range. You don't have to remember all those things, first of all, because the examination is open book, and you can take all those slides or the lecture notes. So, but one thing you should know is this one. This is the thickness of the viscous sublayer. That's an important one. It's 11.6 times the viscosity divided by the U star, the friction velocity. I found currently in my research for hydraulic transport, so transport of slurry through a pipeline, that this thickness is very important in what exactly is happening in the pipeline. If I have a higher viscosity, I get a thicker layer, and the behavior in the pipeline is different. In fact, in that hydraulic transport, one thing they also use is, maybe you can imagine that if you have that viscous sublayer, normally it's fluid flow, and nice linear velocity distribution. But what happens if I have a lot of very fine particles inside that viscous sublayer? Then those particles make it more difficult for the fluid to slide over each other, because in fact in the viscous sublayer, you start at the sediment with velocity zero, and then each level of water is flowing a little bit faster, so you get layers of water sliding over each other. But if there are particles, they obstruct this sliding of the layers of water. Effectively, that means the viscosity of the fluid is increasing. And they have equations for that. And for example, if I would have an 0.1 millimeter sand, 40% concentration, then the viscosity increases by a factor 12, based on certain equations. That means suddenly my viscous sublayer is 12 times as thick, because my viscosity is increasing. That means that much bigger particles are still 100% in the viscous sublayer. And that's what is actually happening, and you can see that in many measurements. You can, well, not directly, but you can explain things that you measure by increasing the viscosity. Okay, that's it for today. And I thought I would finish the whole subject today, but probably I talk too much. You say yes.